During the time of the dinosaurs, the skies above were ruled by a group of winged creatures that, though fairly well known to the general populace, at least at the surface level, remain, in my humble opinion, some of the most criminally underrated of all prehistoric animals, the pterosaurs. Just like the dinosaurs, pterosaurs, not pterodactyls, that's not a thing, they're called pterosaurs, can trace their humble beginnings to the Triassic period, and in their early days were all rather small and, dare I say, not overly impressive. But through the following Jurassic and Cretaceous periods, as they steadily consolidated their dominion of the skies, they diversified into a kaleidoscopic array of forms, from seafaring fish hunters to highly specialized and utterly bizarre filter feeders, from tiny bat-like creatures to borderline eldritch monsters tall enough to look a giraffe in the eye and with wingspans over 10 meters across. But pterosaurs did not rule the skies solo. For a sizable chunk of their tenure, these fascinating creatures shared their lofty domain with a more familiar flock of flies, a strange little group of dinosaurs whose ancestors first took to the air during the Jurassic, and today they survive as the very essence of nature's conquest of the skies. They are, of course, the birds. For tens of millions of years, birds and pterosaurs would flip, flap, and fly, moving together in the same big sky. But eventually the latter group came to meet their demise at the hands of the infamous Chicxulub asteroid impact that marked the end of the Cretaceous. While the birds persisted to this very day, where they remain as an ever-present testament to the indomitable legacy of the dinosaurs. But while it's pretty much unanimously agreed that the Chicxulub asteroid impact dealt the final blow to the pterosaurs' reign, some have proposed that it was not the only factor, and that pterosaurs may have already been on their way out before the asteroid eventually swept in as the ultimate coup de grace. In particular, the idea that pterosaurs were being steadily outcompeted by birds in the expanse of time leading up to their demise is a common factoid in mainstream discourse about these animals, and has been further popularized by documentaries like Walking with Dinosaurs. But as we learned with the whole Leviathan versus Megalodon kerfuffle, common knowledge about animals living or extinct often isn't knowledge at all, and erroneous claims can easily become firmly ingrained into the minds of the general populace. So, were pterosaurs really being outcompeted by birds? Well, there's a few lines of reasoning that tend to get invoked in this discussion, and I personally suspect that perhaps the main driving factor is the general understatement of pterosaurs as a whole, which is in itself part of a persistent trend of downplaying older groups of animals with respect to modern ones. Are you kidding me? Early reconstructions of pterosaurs were unflattering, to say the least. In the days of yore, they were seen as rather hideous yet impotent creatures, nature's crude prototype of a flying animal, a mere shadow of the supposedly more advanced birds to which they would one day surrender the skies. Yet, roughly at the turn of the millennium, a slew of discoveries saw a radical shift in our scientific understanding of pterosaurs. Creatures once seen as scaly, cold-blooded gliders were now regarded as active, energetic flyers, with warm blood and a fuzzy coat of hair-like pycnofibers. Yet the wider public's perception of pterosaurs, as well as their portrayal in popular media, has remained largely stuck in the past. All I can say here is thank goodness for prehistoric planet. And not only have pterosaurs gotten a serious glow-up over the last couple decades, at least a couple of their most significant supposed weaknesses relative to birds have not only been handily debunked, but completely turned on their heads. For any flying animal, one of the most important things is getting into the air, and pterosaurs initially were thought to have struggled with this somewhat in comparison to birds. Early reconstructions often imply they were unable to take off from the ground, typically showing them gingerly scaling vertical surfaces like cliffs in order to reach the elevation needed to get airborne. But more recent findings provide strong evidence that pterosaurs could not only lift themselves off the ground without assistance from the environment, but may very well have possessed a more effective mechanism for takeoff than birds. Birds fly with their wings. Super advanced biology, I know. But their takeoff is almost completely powered by their legs. Two separate functions, two separate pairs of limbs, each operated by different sets of muscles. What this means is that their functionality doesn't overlap. Strong leg muscles may be vital for takeoff, but once a bird is airborne, these same muscles serve no further role and are essentially just dead weight. A big bird can't afford to skip leg day if it wants to fly, but possessing the heavy musculature it needs to get off the ground also means it has to carry a lot more weight once it's airborne, and that places a cap on just how large a bird can get while still being capable of flight. Above a certain size, the muscles required for takeoff would become prohibitively heavy. Pterosaurs, it seems, may not have had such an issue. A study published in 2008 proposed a mechanism for takeoff nicknamed the quad launch, which is well supported by pterosaur anatomy and remains the prevailing explanation for how these animals got airborne to this day. In accordance to this model, pterosaurs would have effectively sprung themselves skywards, propelled by all four limbs, with the front limbs in particular being the driving force behind the takeoff. This method, which is also exhibited by modern vampire bats, would have been a substantially more powerful mode of takeoff compared to that of birds, and is regarded as a key factor that allowed pterosaurs to attain far greater sizes than any flying bird, living or extinct. And the quad launch was not only more powerful, but more efficient. For unlike takeoff in birds, which as aforementioned is driven by the leg muscles, the quad launch would have instead been predominantly facilitated by the forelimbs and pectoral muscles, which were also used for flying. And with launching and flight being operated by the same set of muscles, pterosaurs wouldn't have faced the inconvenience of their takeoff apparatus amounting to mere dead weight once airborne. Another aspect of pterosaur life that was once thought of as a shortcoming compared to birds, but has since done a complete 180 degree flip, is their ability to move about on the ground. To say that retro depictions of pterosaurs were unflattering is putting it very mildly, and this is all the more apparent when it comes to their terrestrial locomotive capabilities. In the mid-20th century, they were typically, at best, portrayed as extremely ungainly walkers, and, at worst, completely incapable of walking at all. All the more reason to hail the early birds as a more advanced and overall superior form of animal. But since then, it has become more and more firmly established that pterosaurs were not only capable of moving on the ground, but were surprisingly competent at it. Subsequent findings, namely fossilized trackways identifiable as those of pterosaurs, have since made it clear that, with the exception of a few smaller, earlier lineages that appeared more adapted for climbing, pterosaurs had an erect quadrupedal gait, with their limbs held vertically beneath them, with which they could not only walk but run. One group, the Ajdakids, which include many of the largest known pterosaurs like Quetzalcoatlus and Hatzegopteryx, aka one of the coolest animals ever, appear to have further refined this terrestrial competence. In a standing pose, their overall limb proportions parallel those of fast-moving hoofed mammals, and this highly efficient upright gait, combined with their long limbs and consequently enormous stride, meant the giant Ajdakids were likely a force to be reckoned with on the ground, with their estimated running speed on par with that of an Olympic sprinter. And similarly to their takeoff, the walking apparatus of pterosaurs complemented their flight in a manner not seen in birds, and for near identical reasons. In birds, walking and flying are driven by two different pairs of limbs, the hind limbs for walking, and the forelimbs for flying. And just like with takeoff, being able to move effectively on the ground requires bigger, stronger leg muscles, which become an additional liability in flight. So, for birds, there's a trade-off between terrestrial and aerial locomotion. There are plenty of birds that are well adapted for walking and running, but they are typically either poor flyers or completely flightless. Meanwhile, pterosaurs, with a much stronger functional overlap between their walking and flying apparatus, could be highly adept at moving on the ground without compromising their proficiency in the air. Takeoff and terrestrial locomotion are perhaps the two most prominent examples of former supposed disadvantages of pterosaurs being completely turned upside down. And these, combined with pterosaurs now being regarded as much more powerful, energetic flyers, with far more complex and sophisticated anatomy than originally thought, as well as being a much more diverse and varied group than once believed, make it pretty clear that these animals were a far cry from the inept, primitive creatures they had long been imagined as. But while it's now well established that pterosaurs were not crude, poorly adapted precursors to birds, but instead versatile and successful animals with their own unique advantages over their avian contemporaries, that alone doesn't quite put the hypothesis that pterosaurs were outcompeted by birds to rest. Trends, or in better wording, apparent trends in the fossil record, have also been touted as evidence that birds were slowly usurping the pterosaurs' rule of the skies. A graphic depiction of pterosaur diversity over time, as known from the fossil record, would appear to suggest these animals peaked around the middle of the Cretaceous period, before sharply declining in the late Cretaceous, a decline that also happens to be accompanied by an increase in the diversity of birds. So if we take the trends apparent in the fossil record at face value, it would seem plausible that birds were steadily outcompeting pterosaurs during the latter part of the Cretaceous. But the key phrase there is at face value. It's assuming that the trends shown by the fossil record are indeed representative of the actual changes in the diversity of pterosaurs over time, and that can be a pretty big assumption to make. Rather notably, it was found that the two most substantial peaks in fossilized pterosaur diversity, the aforementioned peak in the Cretaceous, as well as an earlier, somewhat smaller peak in the late Jurassic, corresponded quite strongly with the ages of a select few formations exhibiting remarkably well-preserved fossils. The peak in the late Jurassic matches the age of the Solenhofen formation, a fossil site so exceptional that even exceedingly delicate animals like jellyfish have been preserved there. And the larger peak in the Cretaceous coincides with a number of similar formations from China and Brazil. Between them, these select few settings comprise less than 5% of the total number of fossil sites in which the remains of pterosaurs have been unearthed, yet they account for nearly 40% of the known diversity of pterosaur species. And though not to the same extent, peaks in the diversity of fossil birds also correspond with the occurrence of a select few exceptional formations. Thus, it would seem that the apparent fluctuation in pterosaur diversity over time can be attributed, at least in part, to preservation bias, with pterosaurs appearing to have been more abundant and diverse in time periods from which we have a rich fossil record, and conversely being underrepresented and notably rarer in other periods where the fossil record isn't quite so comprehensive. Taking trends at face value, therefore, can be a path to dubious conclusions, and it's one of the big no-nos in the boring, though regrettably very important, world of data analysis. Another big no-no is preemptively drawing conclusions from very limited samples, and that is also something that comes into play when unraveling the credibility of the birds versus pterosaurs narrative. The bones of pterosaurs were thin-walled and filled with air, which lightened the animal's skeleton and served as an essential adaptation for flight. But from a paleontological perspective, these ultra-lightweight bones are kind of a pain in the ass, for such delicate structures are extremely unlikely to be fossilized, and the presence of pterosaurs in the fossil record is resultantly rather scant. And conclusions drawn from a dataset as patchy and incomplete as the pterosaur fossil record are, needless to say, hardly the most reliable. Not only can random variation and other confounding factors cause potentially misleading trends to materialize, there is also a lot of room for newer discoveries to shake things up quite significantly. And just such a thing happened with pterosaurs. For quite some time, it had long appeared that pterosaur diversity at the end of the Cretaceous was limited to just one family, the Ajdakans. But around 2018, a fossil assemblage in Morocco yielded the remains of at least seven different pterosaur species, including some that belonged to families hitherto not known from the end of the Cretaceous. Nyctosaurids, like Barbaridactylus, and pteranodontids like Tethytraco. So in the space of a single discovery, the number of pterosaur families known to have made it to the final stage of the Cretaceous went from 1 to 3, upsetting the long-standing narrative that pterosaur diversity at the end of the Cretaceous was at an all-time low. And at around the same time, another fossil discovery challenged another long-held notion regarding the bird-pterosaur dynamic. It's often suggested that birds, if not outcompeting pterosaurs as a whole, were at least outcompeting smaller pterosaurs, and the notable absence of small pterosaur species in late Cretaceous deposits appeared to validate this proposal. But the recent discovery of a tiny Ajdaga dating to the final stage of the Cretaceous bucked this trend, showing small pterosaur species did indeed make it all the way to the bitter end. What's more is that with or without this pint-sized pterosaur in our fossil repertoire, we can still be certain that small pterosaurs were around in the last days of the Cretaceous, because big pterosaurs couldn't have just popped into existence fully grown. They had to start out as babies, and babies are small. Yet curiously, in spite of the fact that small pterosaurs must have existed in substantial numbers back then because, well, the adults had to come from somewhere, the remains of early life stages of large pterosaurs are nigh non-existent in late Cretaceous strata, suggesting, once again, that their abundance has been majorly undersampled due to the intrinsic preservation bias against pterosaur remains as a result of their gracile anatomy, a bias that would only be more significant in the case of small juveniles. Thus, given the paucity of fossils of baby pterosaurs that we know must have existed at the time, it's safe to say that the presence of small pterosaurs in the late Cretaceous, be they small pterosaur species or babies of big pterosaur species, has largely slipped under the radar due to the imperfection of the fossil record. Once again, a key aspect of the birds outcompeting pterosaurs proposal can be reasonably chalked down to limited sampling of the latter. So, the idea that birds were outcompeting pterosaurs, which, even at the best of times, was not very well supported, seems to only be becoming less and less plausible by the day. But still, there's no getting around the fact that pterosaurs are extinct and birds continue to thrive, as you can hear all around me. So, surely that must mean something. Well, yes and no. For even though birds did survive the Cretaceous extinction event, it wasn't exactly a walk in the park for them, with multiple major lineages being completely wiped out. As for the fortunate few that survived, it's possible that their ticket to success was being able to exploit a food source that neither pterosaurs nor most other birds at the time were adapted to feed on. Seeds. In the post-apocalyptic wasteland left behind by the Chicxulub asteroid impact, seeds would have been one of the only viable sources of nourishment left, and being able to eat them could have given the birds a critical edge. But does that necessarily make them superior to pterosaurs? I'd say not. Birds and pterosaurs were both adapted for their own lifestyles. Some birds occupied niches that no pterosaur did, and likewise, some pterosaurs occupied niches that no bird ever did. They each had their own unique quirks, advantages, and disadvantages. And it just so happens that the Chicxulub asteroid impact shook things up in a manner that was slightly less unfavourable to the birds. So while the pterosaurs sadly perished, the birds were able to hang on by a thread. A thread that made all the difference between oblivion and a further 66 million years of living and flourishing. And finally, we arrive at the end of a long, tedious, and hopefully not too boring video. If the incredible world of prehistory interests you, here's a playlist of my paleontology-focused content. And if you find my channel appealing, then you are welcome to subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I shall see you again next time.